All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'll be your host chair. Good morning.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello everyone, good morning. Good morning. Okay. May we ask everyone to enter and be seated, and this conference will be started in 5 minutes. Okay. Carry on. Yes. Right. All right, good morning, everyone. Before I start it, you can scan the QR code here. That's our feedback form for today. If you fill in the feedback form later, we have a lucky draw, or you can the activity you can attend. Yeah. So before we start the event, maybe you can take a few seconds doing it. Can you scan the QR code? Is that all right? Yeah, but you can answer it later, but you can scan it first. Then we will wait no longer to start this event in 2 minutes. All right, without further ado, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second and the last day also to the 2023 Asian Advanced Automotive Manufacturing Summit. I'll go back to this banner. Our topic is flexible and production and EV solutions today. I'm Jack. I'm Jack Chen, and I'm your host today. We had a total of 9 presentations from the industry experts yesterday, and we hope that you learn a lot from our speakers. And today, we will get a chance to add to your knowledge with presentations from industry experts in the automotive and also motorcycle industry. First, we acknowledge our partner associations who have helped us put this two-day event together. So prepare your hands. First, Indonesian Automotive Parts and Components Industries Association. Thank you. Second, Indonesian Society for Quality, ISQ. And also Indonesia ISO Expert Association, IIEA, which will be also our speaker later. We're looking forward to it. Our business partners, without whom this conference would not be possible. HE Laser, CP Chemie, Shaman Golden Agri special alloy, and Cam Metal. Thank you, Catherine. HBR Magnetics, Dongguan Chenxing Laser Technology, all of them, please. We also express our thanks to the participation of those organizations through their representatives. Association of Indonesia Automotive Industry, Gaikindo. The Association of Indonesia Motorcycle Industry, AISI, and the Toyota Indonesia Academy. Let's all give them a warm applause. All right. Now I know you're all ready for the presentations, but before that, we have a few reminders. For some of them may listen to these reminders already, but I have to say it again. Firstly, please kindly switch your cell phone to silent mode while you're in this conference room. Thank you very much. Second, please wear your name tag, your badge, all the time during the conference time. The name plate with blue lace is for delegates, yellow for sponsors, exhibitors, and red for speakers. So note that your name tags include your meal coupons, which you will have to present in the buffet for the free lunch today. We also encourage you, number three, to join our WhatsApp group. WhatsApp discussion group for the better on-site communication. Here are the steps. First, you have to download the WhatsApp app from Google Play or App Store. Second, register your number. Third, scan the QR code or ask our staff here to pass you to the group. We will also post the photos and other informations to into that group. Number four, more importantly, we recommend that you also ask questions, share your comments with our speakers. We will have a Q&A time, open forum time after each speaker. So prepare your questions, have discussions. It will benefit to this group as well. Number five, you will also find the rest of the guideline in the brochure. You make sure you read your brochure, so take a moment to check it out later. And since today is our last day, we hope that you will participate in the survey, which I, the QR code I show you. Thank you very much. And by filling the survey, you can join the lucky draw later too. All right, so let's start the sessions for today. Our first speaker is Vice Chairman, Industrial Film and Technology Competitiveness of Indonesian Automotive Parts and Components Industries Association, GIAMM. Guillaume. He is Guillaume, right? Guillaume. His presentation will provide an overview on the progress of flexible manufacturing in Indonesia. Let's all welcome Mr. Adrian Dickey Burhan.
Please use this microphone.
Yeah.
And the clicker is here. I'll open the file.
Thank you, Jack. We talk about first of all, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Diki. I'm representing GIAM, Gabungan Industri Otomotif dan Manufacturing di Indonesia. Today, I'll present the recent progress of Agile production system in Indonesia. In my experience working in GIAM and also in ADM as a senior general manager currently. Okay, so first, I will convey the what is the agile manufacturing and what is the basic feature of the agile manufacturing, and then what is the global production plan, because when you want to have a flexible system, you cannot neglect the demand of the export. As for your information, that Indonesia has about 20% of the production going to export. And we need to take care of course the demand on the export, not only the domestic. And the infrastructure that we established recently for the supporting the flexible manufacturing system, if you don't have the infrastructure, then it is quite difficult for you to make the flexible operation here. And I will give you my conclusion. Okay. What is the definition of the agile manufacturing itself? That is a process a strategy to reduce lead time to meet your good response in the manufacturing line. So how, what is the power of an organization to pivot the power, the management to follow the fluctuation to the production line. And it focuses on meeting the customer demands while maintaining high standards. So agility is not agile if you sacrifice your quality, okay? It's not agility. Flexibility, which also increase your cost, it's not a flexibility. It's not agility. Agility should not sacrifice the quality and the cost and the delivery of your product and production system. It is agility, okay? And of course, it involves technology, of course, good processes, product design. Your design should be also comply to the flexible manufacturing. Information system, this is very, very important also. You need to have some IT level improvement and also partners. Remember that as a manufacturer, your partner is supplier, right? You cannot cancel your order to supplier and supplier will leave you, okay? So this is also, you need to improve the connection to supplier. And also, of course, recently, knowledge, training, skill of the manpower, you need also to provide the skill for your manpower to be agile, sir. And it enables to have a real-time changing of the market. I will share you some of our experience in manufacturing Indonesia, dealing with the fluctuation of Indonesian market and also export. As you know that after the pandemic, export country limit their importation, reduction of the export currently happening. But that is usually in our operation. Fluctuation of demand is usually happening. Okay? And then what is the challenges in currently in Indonesia, especially for the automotive? First is that the increasing complexity, a bit offer of latest technology is necessary, okay? Number two is, of course, shortening production cycle. And third, of course, increased pressure to innovate. And finally, the react quickly to the changing of the fluctuation is very important. The top management can change quickly, but however, our operator, our machine, our management need also to have some certain system to achieve the flexibility. So we focus on three agility in Indonesia. First, agility is focusing on the product development. Our product development should meet the requirement of the market. Otherwise, your product won't sell. Okay. And secondly, agile product project management. In order to make a new model, the minor change, the full model change, you need to have a standard lead time. Otherwise, your competitor will release the commercial their vehicle and then you are left behind. And then when you commercialize your vehicle, it won't have momentum of sale. Okay? Third is the agile supply chain. When there is a fluctuation of order, when there is a fluctuation of the market demand, how do your supply chains react to that fluctuation is very important. Okay, you have to have some certain level of system. I will explain to you how we manage the situation. And then we focusing on, of course, the derivative of the agile product project management, which require high level of certainty and then also close with the customer. Approach documentation in the project management document is very important. Okay? And then project plan also to the focus of the organizations and cross-function agility. In the product development, in R&D, you need to have a rapid prototyping, and then low turn time and low consumption until the reduction of inventory. Finally, your supply chain. You need to have a virtual integration of your supply chain. Micron system, right? You know Micron? Okay, and then market sensitivity and of course, process alignment. You know, sometimes in, I don't know, in China, in India, in Indonesia, sometimes sub-Asian part coming from Bogor area, go to Cikarang area for sub-Asian and supply to my factory in Sunter. So the part is like a going holiday. It doesn't give you any value added for that part. You need to take care of it. Okay? So the basic principle of the agility in Indonesia, especially, we are not only focusing on the quality. Basically, no cost up is allowed for the agile product system. If you make improvement of agility, then your cost is up doesn't have any value added for us. So you have to be careful of that. And following this, this is just only theory. I don't expand too much on the theory. Basically, we are in the flexible system. So adjustable program, and we use platform. Platform A, for example, recently many Japanese maker make a platform, right? The underbody is basically common recently. Okay? They just extend the Rocky or race, become Seni Avanza. And then they reduce the underbody of Rocky and race, become Agile. One platform for multiple product. This is trend in Indonesia. And small to medium with common size of the specialized and adjustable system, not a job order system. We cannot do the job order because the volume is already big. And the characteristic of the dedicated flexible manufacturing, first character is determined by the production constraint, workpiece. In the workpiece, you need certain of discipline. Sometimes in here, in China or in Asia, usually they focus not to the geometric of the shape, but focusing on the order and the paper. It is wrong. Okay. Second, all produce systems are non-advanced. That means you have to have a production plan. A company without a good production plan, impossible to follow the market demand. Okay. And of course, impossible to follow the fluctuation and agility itself. And workpiece family based on geometric, I already explained. Big, small, or large. In small product, you use progress lab, you use posting. In the big part number, you use Junbiki and Junate system, just in time system. Okay. And finally, machine are designed for not for a specific process, so that production ranges can be widened. Okay. And this is the basic characteristic. Basically, just what is the machine flexibility is measured by the how many product can be produced by one machine. And secondly, material handling is measured by the, how many different type of product can be transported in your company. And then finally, operation. Operation is very important. Okay, you cannot focus only the manufacturing. You need also to focus on the production operation plan. Okay. This is what I'm doing for about 17 years as general managers in Asaradas Motor. So this is the flow of order. So we receive order from domestic market and then go to the distributor. In Indonesia, you have to separate distributor and the manufacturing, okay? This is a regulation. So we collect from distributor A and export order also from other country, destination country, pull up to the regional office. Ma, currently still in Thailand. My dream someday will be moved to Indonesia. Okay. And then go to the brand principal A. If you are Daihatsu, go to Daihatsu brand. If you are Toyota, go to Toyota brand and the other brand. And then go to the basic. This is the very important position, is basic allocation. How many order you receive? Are you going to supply all? There is a policy on that. Okay. And then go to the our manufacturing. Then production control, instruct the global production plan and allocation to each plant that you have and produce the vehicle using the GIT system and production instruction system, scanning and the other, go to the vehicle logistic, supply the domestic and also the export. This is the basic common practice in India. Next. So we have four types of production and operation plan. At first, is annual plan, original annual plan, and revised annual plan. So, it contains of 3 years production plan by models, unit, and what line that car will be produced. You need to have control that one. Sales forecast, and of course, the most important is equipment capacity. A process without capacity, then your process will have an effective fallout of the quality. And your manpower will be also fluctuated. Okay. So also manpower check. Remember, when you have a manual process in here, not all the process in Indonesia is automated yet. Unlike in Japan or China or USA, we still rely on people, right? So when you still rely on people, that means that your quality and your productivity relies on the skill of your manpower. Your skill of the manpower is low, then your productivity will be low, your quality will be low, and vice versa also. And to make after 1 year, then we have a 4 month forecast. So we give to the supplier 4 month forecast. Usually, due to the complexity of the business, the automaker won't give the forecast to the supplier. Why? Because they don't want to give a promise to the supplier. But the supplier order 1 month before the material, from imported material, unfortunately many material from Indonesia is imported from China and other countries. They already shipped 1 month ago. So how can you change the production? Then your supplier will leave you. You do like that. So that's why N, we order N, N plus 1 up to N plus 3. And to check the in-house of the supplier capacity, doesn't, if you have an agile production system, it doesn't mean that your supplier should follow you. If they don't have capacity, they cannot supply it to you, and then line stop will happen, right? In my company, 1 minute line stop is 100 million rupiah. So 10 times 1 billion rupiah. You have 3 billion. One day. Okay. Can you imagine if you have 20 days of line stop? Very devastated on the profitability of manufacturing. Okay. So supplier is very important. Not only in-house capacity, but also supplier's capacity. Check. And also derivative to daily plan. Okay. In daily plan, you make a plan arrange with the possible timing to meet the sales demand itself, operation level. Sometimes our distributor said, oh, sorry, I need Xenia more faster than Terios. You need to have to hear their demand and then arrange your production and then write out the sequence of your production. Okay? And then finally, the most important is our daily operation is the worst. Work order instruction. So from what is WOC order instruction? Basically, is ELT, vehicle language tag, which content of 200 specification of vehicle put in the system, and then follow the sequence of the production based on IT, instruct the part order based on that ELT system. That is what we have in Indonesia. Okay, it's not very low. Indonesia has some big progress or good progress on the production system. Okay, so this is the illustration in the bottom. So once we release production plan, we release 3 years. 2024? No, this is 2023, right? So next year in January, you should release January 2024, 25, and 26 production plan. That coming from the communication with your export customers and domestic customers. How is your forecast? Without forecast, we cannot make a plan. Then, based on that, we make a profit plan. Remember, production plan is not manpower planning, right? Sales plan is not production plan. If it is all the same, then it is impossible to control the planning itself. After that, we release January and revise in the July, also coming to N plus 2. So every 6 months, we make a confirmation on these 3 years forecast, okay? After 1 year, we already forecast month by month, 3 years. Then we go to the monthly operation plan, which the rule is N should be fixed because your N already planned in N minus 1. If you change the fix in the N, then your supplier will complain to you. How is my air freight? Because from China, from Japan, they use sea freight, right? And then suddenly you change N plus 1. They will charge you the air freight. This is not cheap. Very expensive. Even the sea freight currently not yet recovered from the pandemic condition. So it's very important to keep the rule. N plus 1, you can change the order 20%. Why 20%? Because you can cover that 20% from overtime. You have daily overtime. You have also Saturday, Sunday. You can use that one to meet the fluctuation of demand in N plus 1. N plus 3 is 60% you can change, and N plus 4 you can change freely. This is our flexible production system. And then go to the N1, we go to the daily production plan, okay, which focusing on really day by day work instruction to your line, to your logistic. And then remember, also the last one is the WASP, the day shift and night shift. The day shift and night shift, basically the same job, the same operation, only the difference is night and day only. Okay? So I continue. This is the how do we manage the order from distributor, a joint meeting first, sales review meeting, and then go to the distributor marketing for marketing operation plan, how much your order, what color, color by color, and then production control make a capacity study on the supplier and internal process, order evaluation, is this okay or not, go to the pull request, and then go to the allocation operation, go to N plus one operation of delivery plan, and allocation based on branch and dealer of the distributor. This is the basic system that we have marketing. Next. And the monthly, basically, we don't change in N, but N plus 1, 20% again, we flow in N plus 2. Allocation follow the last month ratio in N, because already order in last month. We cannot change that ratio, okay? And then this is the ordering. Kehen means changing the plan, okay? You have a plan, but unfortunately, there is a many abnormality in Indonesia, traffic jam and the other shortage, then you need to change the plan. How do you change the plan? So basically ask the distributor first, is it okay to change the plan? And then issue the request official letter to the principal to supply the CKD component, imported component, which is still from the principal. And then if it is yes, go to the color. For Indonesia, basically we can change the order of color in 5 days. Because first day, they need to flush the painting equipment, clean it up, and then change with the new color with the cartridge. Okay, that takes about 1 or 2 days, and then production lead time is about 2 days, so 5 days is enough to change the color. Okay, and then go input by order again, running daily operation supplier to the distributor. Basically, this logic is happening in current system in Indonesia. And if your production need to increase. Sometimes in Indonesia, there is a many event, and then suddenly you need to increase your order. So this is the logic. The transportation from Japan on China, Indonesia, basically driver part should be considered for about 1 month in the sea and after custom clearance. Okay? So what you do is when the production increase, you need to control your stock. Now our standard is basically 3 days on stock. If over than that, we do not comply, we cannot comply, we said to our principal and distributor, sorry, I give up because my stock already less than 3 days. So that means you have to control the part arrival. And you have also make a part-by-part system. Previously, we use lot system. When one bolt is disappeared, then this lot is fitted already, okay? But currently, Indonesia have already achieved the level of part-by-part ordering. You know, 11,000. Component of automotive of combustion engine. So temporary stock reduction until part arrival must be managed. This is the logic of the changing operation during the plant. Of course, the supplier will complain to you, but sometimes we have no choice. Then you have to pay the air freight if you do it like this. So this is the global production plan rules and policy that basically, all companies follow the capacity investment and business plan on the annual plan. And then all activities are executed following the original plan. If there is changing, then confirm all. Okay. Secondly, if your demand is less than supply, then you follow the last month allocation plan. But if your demand is bigger than the supply, that means that you need to add some allocation. Okay, allocation basically should be fair between the company involved. And this is basically what I already explained to you to fasten. So what we must do, why we must do such this kind of thing, that because of the component and also platform is also used with the other factory. For example, Toyota has another factory in outside Indonesia, and also Daihatsu also has another factory, and the others also need to be shared for global. So we cannot decide by ourselves. You have to confirm all the related party involved in that. Sorry. This is what infrastructure, this is the last slide I want to present, that we have in Indonesia, basically press for the body, moving bolster system, which guarantee the short boundary of the dies. It will be have, we have GSPH about 550 to 600 gross stroke per hour, okay, that level for flexible manufacturing. Multi-production with the pattern, not producing A, B within one day, but also mix A, B, C like that to meet the junta. And painting robotic system, the underbody, it requires the body accuracy more than 95%. So if your body accuracy less than 95%, you cannot implement the underbody sealer system. It will have an effect on you. And robotic spray, of course. The multiple program, what kind of body, sedan, SUV, and the other, you can do it with the robotic system. And last is the jig-less system. So all the jig is held by robot, not a fixed jig or clamp. Okay, this is the previous technology already. You already implemented the system. So any type of body can be changed. And of course, service part is very easy, right? Please remember that if you are producing a vehicle, you need to take care of your service part. Otherwise, your resale value will be low. Your customer won't buy your car because it cannot be serviced. Very important. You need to guarantee that. And this is the global production, sorry, this is the latest. And secondly, assembly. Okay, if you have assembling, is where it's the core of the manufacturing is assembly, because assembling made the car complete. Okay, you have selective part system and progress line based on order. It does SPS, a selected part system. So when you scan the barcode, they go shopping in your line, and then only the part needed for the dead vehicle is go to the line. So you don't need the line size stop. Then you can see the standardized work in your line operation. And finally, also the direct posting and cash deal. For example, why you order bumper? Meanwhile, the trimming assembly process already always trimming chassis and final. The part of trimming should be ordered first, then finalized. Okay. Otherwise, your workshop, your warehouse will be full of the part. So you need to calculate the depth of ordering. Trimming first you order, and then chassis part first, and then final part later. Do not order the final part in the beginning, otherwise the bumper will overflow your warehouse. That will be all my presentation, Jack. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. That's a big mouth to the speaker. Okay. As I mentioned, we're gonna have an open forum. Let's ask one question. We have one slot. Okay, right there. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Padiki. It's interesting that you mentioned about the WOS, the sequencer, or is better known as advanced planning and scheduling. I do know that in ADM you have WAS as a software that you
years ago. Yeah.
And you have something similar or even better than that.
Yeah.
But the question I have is that I think in ADM you have that, and it helps you to do the sequencing, right?
Yes,
and schedule, and together with the manufacturing, it helps you to be more productive.
Yes.
I think the question is that a majority of your tier one and tier two suppliers are doing all this in person, right? Or in paper. And, they do have ERP, for example, but they don't have all these tools, software. And, how do you, as an OEM, help the tier one, tier two suppliers more productive in sequencing or scaling?
Thank you, Mr. It's quite challenging because at first we established the ERP in Japanese system is Kanban. Basically, it's the same, only the name is different. ERP, Kanban, or electronic order. First, in Indonesia, unfortunately, we start with the network. First, we convert the manual order to the digital order first. That is first step. And then you need to check the infrastructure of your suppliers. Make sure they have emails. and access to the internet first, the infrastructure. And then secondly, we do training, Pak. The training how to make, how to read order, and then how to accept the order and up until the instruction to the their production line. Remember, lead time is not the production, okay? Lead time is the time A is from the manufacturer to the supplier. That is A lead time. And then after the supplier receipt, it doesn't mean that they directly produce your order, right? You need to also consider B lead time, which is the order to instruct the production to their production line, and then machining lead time or production lead time B. And finally, one product cannot be directly delivered to your company. It needs a quantity per Kanban or per quantity box, right? One box then supply to your company. This lead time sometimes long in the supplier. So what we do is first check the infrastructure part and then teach them how to proceed this order and teach them the logic of the production sequence itself. That is what we are doing. Next, of course, currently I'm in charge for the education. So we'll continue also the manufacturing competency on each level of the production is very important. No matter how much system we make, good system, without supporting from the skill of the manpower, it will collapse. That is what we do. From now, totally 300 suppliers we have. I hope it satisfies your question, Pak.
Okay, thank you for answering. And that's all for the first speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, the big hands for the first speaker. Now I would like to introduce the second speaker. Our next speaker is presently the Secretary General of the Association of Indonesia Motorcycle Industry. He has years of experience in Indonesia's motorcycle and automotive sectors and held key positions in leading companies. Let's all welcome Mr. Harry Budiando.
Please use this microphone
and check.
Check the yeah, it's working. It's too fun.
Terima kasih. Thank you, Jack. Yeah, for the time. Yeah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera buat kita semua. Saya gaduh-gaduh ya bahasa Indonesia, bahasa Inggris. Yeah. It will be different presentation with the first presentation. Because I will focusing on the market overview regarding the two-wheeler business. Yeah, IC is a Indonesia Association Motorcycle Industry. Yeah, saya on behalf of IC Harry Budiando sebagai Sekretaris Jenderal. Yeah, saya juga I also Sekretaris Jenderal of IATO. IATO is Indonesia ahli automotive, teknik automotive, automotive apa ya? SAE Chapter Indonesia, Society Automotive Engineer Indonesia ya, Ikatan Ahli Teknik Otomotif Indonesia. Jadi untuk kali ini, for this time, I will inform about the Indonesia market update ya. Ya, pertanyaan pertama. Tentang sepeda motor. Kita tahu bahwa sepeda motor itu selalu menjadi motorcycle is always become the some discussion because the volume creating the traffic jam, but in the other hand, this is very important regarding the people mobility which is masyarakat itu paling terjangkau menggunakannya. More than 70% the market share of the apa the market of the two wheeler is the middle low. Ya, yeah. In bahasa kenapa sih in the medium in income country like Indonesia ya, sepeda motor itu menjadi mobilitas alat mobilitas utama transportasi di Indonesia. Ya pertama karena memang secara investasi resale value-nya bagus. Okay. The resale value of two-wheeler in Indonesia is very good ya, for the middle low segment ya. The second, this is the most efficient transportation mode ya in Indonesia. Bisa dipakai kemana aja, kapan aja. Yeah. Different with the mass transportation. Mass transportation is in Indonesia still very limited. Limited the time issue, the point destination issue also something like that. Yeah. The second, the third is the motorcycle ini menjadi alat produksi. Karena di middle income low, untuk berkegiatan ekonomi, ekonomi adalah kegiatan perpindahan barang dan jasa. Tanpa alat transportasi, proses itu akan menjadi tidak bisa cepat. Sehingga di sektor itu ada yang dipakai untuk ojek, untuk pengantar barang, segala macam gitu ya. Sehingga ini menjadi key gitu ya. Syarat untuk bisa, apa ya, kalau nanti, kita nanti bicara dengan EV, kenapa sih nanti akan ada pertanyaan, EV-nya kok adopsinya lambat ya? Nanti saya tampilkan ini supaya bisa apa, bisa memberikan jawaban. Masalah bukan hanya harga, tetapi itu tadi. Untuk alat berkegiatan ekonomi, bisa dipakai kemana aja, kapan aja. Nah, seperti itu ya. Nah, gitu ya. Yang terakhir ya tentunya harga yang terjangkau. Dan pemerintah terlalu fokus di sini. Pikirannya harga aja yang menjadi masalah. Dikasih kuota 200.000, 200.000 kuota of incentive, until now it's about 12.000 yang diambil oleh masyarakat. Next. Ya, yeah, ini I think I will start ya. Yeah. The demand of the motorcycle, this is depending on the number one is the economic factor. Every improvement of the GDP growth, yeah, this is will improve the daya beli masyarakat. Yeah. This is also will increase the our demand for two-wheeler. Yeah. The second is infrastructure. Yeah. This is a public transportation coverage in rural area. This is still is a problem. Yeah. Development of public transportation right now in Jakarta and the most big city in Java, actually not only Java, in Indonesia also, under development mainly public transportation. This is also will creating the demand fluctuation of the motorcycle. Yeah. But actually in Indonesia, not like in Japan. Yeah, mass transportation is still waiting for. Yeah, actually the journey is limited time. Yeah, but waiting is too many time, something like that. Yeah. Jadi terlalu lama nunggu-nunggunya. Terus setengah jam baru bisa ada kereta berikutnya, gitu. Nah, this is masih menjadi problem, gitu ya. Nah, yang ketiga adalah teknologi faktor. Teknologi always disrupt the old technology. Nah, di sini nanti kita banyak diskusi mengenai yang saat ini sedang vibe ya, mengenai EV development. Di samping juga ada sharing ekonomi. Anak saya itu sudah nggak mau lagi gitu ya, istilahnya beli mobil segala macam gitu ya, nyetir gitu ya. Nah, hal-hal kayak gini ini akan membuat perilaku market yang berbeda untuk kedepannya. Nah, yang terakhir adalah masalah sosial demografi faktor. Ya, kita tahu ya, ada pemerintah kita sedang mengejar Indonesia Emas di 2045. Karena kita juga akan menikmati demografi faktor ini, apa bonus demografi. Tetapi seperti yang banyak dikatakan para pengamat juga, itu akan menjadi bonus kalau memang kita produktivitas kita meningkat. Tetapi akan jadi gandolin gitu istilahnya ya. Jadi like gitu ya. Kalau sebaliknya, kita growth ekonominya nggak bisa ngikutin itu semuanya gitu ya. Jadi kita punya beban bagaimana menambah pertumbuhan ekonomi yang sekarang rata-rata 5 gitu ya. Itu udah bagus ya. Itu udah bagus, tapi kita butuh untuk keluar dari medium ekonomi trap kita gitu ya, mesti ada tambahan. Makanya sebenarnya gitu ya, banyak hilirisasi tambang-tambang kita, terutama nikel. Kita memanfaatkan dari apa namanya gelombang pasangnya EV yang lagi hype gitu. Bukan EV-nya yang menjadi EV penting karena untuk masalah iklim. Tetapi gelombang pasangnya ini kalau kita naik untuk proses peningkatan value dari produk-produk tambang kita yang sangat kaya ya, terutama nikel, ada kobalt juga, ada yang lain gitu. Ini akan memberikan mesin pertumbuhan baru dari 5% yang sudah ada sekarang. Nah, itu sebenarnya target yang diinginkan bersama. Dan saya hari ini akan memberikan masalah marketnya 2023 sama proyeksi dari 2024. Jadi kalau teman-teman di sini banyak in manufacturing business ya, this is about the demand, the market size. Yeah. It's very important ya. Yeah. I think it's very important. Yeah. This is motorcycle currently. Yeah. Indonesia itu punya contribution. Indonesia market two-wheeler contribution in ASEAN is about 50% contribution buat market two-wheeler. Yeah. In this chart, yeah, we can see map, yeah. We can see, yeah, is Thailand this year, yeah, this is the first semester of this year, Thailand is improved, the two-wheeler business is about 10%. Vietnam is decreasing about 13%. Philippines is increasing about 7%, yeah. Malaysia is decreasing about 5%. Singapore is decreasing about 3%. In Indonesia, you see this, improving more than 50%. Jadi tahun lalu kita itu closing di 5,2 juta domestic market two wheeler. Tahun ini sampai dengan bulan Oktober, until Oktober is already 5.2 million. It's already same like last year achievement. And will be close at about 6.2 million in this year. I will see you later. Yeah, yeah, this is about the last 13 years. Yeah, yeah. I will show you about this year. This is this year will this year and next year. We will have the general election. But you see the in this year, yeah, 2019, this is still slightly improved. Jadi don't worry about the election. Yeah. This is also it's yeah, can be creating some demand, also can decreasing, depend on the situation. Yeah. This is 2020. Actually, we have the worst. 2017, because this is a weakening of global economy and also in Indonesia last and that years, yeah, government is regulate the DP-nya gitu ya, DP-nya itu harus 20-25% gitu ya. Nah ini Indonesia, jadi untuk pembelian sepeda motor itu hampir 80% ke atas itu masih menggunakan skema leasing. Jadi tergantung di situ ada DP-nya juga. Karena tadi market kita itu ada di segmen medium low utamanya ya gitu. Ya. Jadi di situ dan di situ ada pentingnya down payment gitu ya. Yang nah, di sini waktu 2017 ini akhirnya pemerintah memberikan relaksasi kembali. Jadi relaksasi sehingga alhamdulillah gitu ya di 2018 itu kita udah kembali improve. Tetapi sayang memang waktu itu di 2020 kita rencananya sudah di angka sekitar 6,6 juta, tetapi ternyata semua negara terimbas COVID-19. Ya. Di sini kita turun sampai 43% di tahun 2020. Tapi cepat kita mengalami recovery di 2021 itu sudah tumbuh di 5 juta lebih gitu kembali itu 38%. Nah tahun 2022 ada yang nanya pasti kok itu tumbuhnya dikit banget pak ya gitu. Jadi saat itu di 2022 kita itu mengalami shortage dari semiconductor. Jadi saat itu demand kita di Mei itu hampir setengahnya dari normalnya yang 500 ribuan itu kita hampir setengahnya itu. Salah satu anggota kami yang paling kuat gitu ya, di bulan Agustus bisa memperbaiki supply chain-nya. Sehingga di bulan Agustus bisa recovery. Karena yang satu merek itu kontribusinya hampir 78% market share. Begitu yang satu itu bisa recovery, yang lainnya juga keangkat gitu ya. Nah di sini, tapi alhamdulillah masih tumbuh di 5,2 juta. Dan tahun ini karena masalah itu juga sudah solve ya, kita insya Allah bisa tumbuh sampai 6,2 juta. Ini berita bagusnya gitu. Nah kalau mengenai, ya ini sebenarnya dari domestic marketnya ini sampai dengan September tumbuh 2-3% gitu ya, year on. Ini year on ya, mantumannya ya, mantuman di tahun yang lalu dengan tahun yang sekarang. Sedikit di kanan itu, nanti kalau saya sharing mungkin saya akan skip ini ya, tapi kalau dilihat saja boleh gitu ya. Karena memang ada salah satu merek kita, anggota kita yang berkeberatan mengenai market share ya. Terus yang ini adalah mengenai domestik secara apa namanya? Oh tadi yang maaf yang ini tadi adalah total production kita ya, domestik plus ekspor kita. Ini tumbuh 23%, sedangkan untuk yang domestiknya saja itu masih tumbuh 30%-an untuk sampai dengan September. Nanti yang sampai dengan Oktober saya tambahin slide berikutnya gitu. Nah, untuk ekspornya kita mengalami penurunan. Aneh kan gitu ya. Ekspornya. Tetapi gini, kebetulan kami we publish to the government is about the CBU export. CBU export is decreasing 44%. But actually, we are have increasing in Cicadis skin. Jadi masih meningkatnya di situ. Jadi CBU-nya turun, Cicadis-nya meningkat. Nah, cuma mungkin kita akan memberikan revisi laporan kita ke pemerintah itu di tahun depan karena kita mesti bersepakat dengan anggota juga mengenai apa mulai memberikan data yang sama gitu ya. Itu nanti insya Allah di tahun 2024 kita akan tampilkan untuk data yang ekspor baik CBU maupun CKD maupun part by part ya, sehingga kita nanti sebenarnya ekspor kita naik gitu ya. Cuma kalau hanya melihat CPU-nya seolah-olah turun. Nah, ini masalah transformasi ya. Nah, di beberapa kategori. Kategori kita ini dulu ingat ya tahun remember in 20 about the 2000 we started with the Matic Vario Matic ya. Jadi waktu itu Pak Matic ya. Posisinya itu kira-kira gitu ya. Berkebalikan. Dulu tipe cup-nya ini, merajai seperti ini, di tipe Matic sekarang gitu ya. Tapi mengalami transformasi pelan-pelan karena apa? Karena memang Matic ini lebih unisex. Bisa dipakai wanita, bisa dipakai anak-anak, bisa dipakai laki-laki. Dan itu nggak ada malu-malunya juga, maksudnya ya sama aja gitu ya. Sama-sama kerennya gitu ya. Nah dengan produk yang apa variannya juga banyak banget gitu ya. Nah saat ini, tipe Matic kita itu hampir menguasai 90%. Sekarang udah 89,8%. Itu Matic, Pak. Jadi kalau ngomongin komponennya gitu ya, yang diproduksi, mestinya nanti banyak kan komponen yang Matic ya. Walaupun ya di sisi motor bakarnya sama, cuma di sisi transmisinya gitu ya akan terjadi perbedaan. Nah, sedangkan yang tipe Sport gitu ya, itu ya flat apa slightly same gitu ya. Is about 6% gitu. Nah yang tipe bebek ya, tipe cup gitu ya kita bilangnya, itu semakin turun sampai di angka 5%. Nah nanti kalau apa namanya supply chain yang masih masih memproduksi yang tipe-tipe cup ini, ya mesti membuat transformasi juga untuk bisa membuat produk-produk atau komponen yang ada di sisi Matic ini. Nanti akan terjadi juga, kenapa kita tampilkan ini? Kejadiannya akan sama dengan EV. Tidak serta-merta itu merubah dengan waktu yang cepat. Ini terjadi dalam waktu hampir 20 tahun. Bisa menguasai pasar seperti ini. Gitu. Jadi transformasi tidak akan berjalan dengan sangat cepat, tetapi akan lambat, tetapi pasti. Gitu. Itu aja yang mau saya katakan. Ini untuk yang tahun ini gitu ya. Nah, ini sampai dengan bulan Oktober kita itu sudah mencapai 5,2 juta tadi saya sampaikan. tumbuhnya domestik masih 26%, gitu ya. Nah, kita masih sisa 2 bulan, jadi November, Desember, dengan rata-rata kita itu 523. Biasanya di akhir tahun terjadi penurunan, karena kan orang kalau mau beli itu kalau mesti dijual lagi. Kalau belinya 2023 Desember gitu ya, ah mending nunggu deh Januari gitu. Jadi Januari akan lebih punya value, resale value-nya lebih tinggi seperti itu. Sehingga di 2 bulan terakhir ini, terutama di bulan terakhir, akan mengalami sedikit penurunannya. Tetapi masih di angka 500 ribu masih dapat ya. Kira-kira makanya kita proyeksikan tahun ini akan bisa di close 6,1 sampai 6,2 juta. Gitu. Ya, ini elektrifikasi, jadi dukungan pemerintah untuk elektrifikasi itu sangat masif ya, karena ini langsung dari Pak Presiden kita gitu ya. Government will always support every investment in electric vehicle in Indonesia and also the development of the upstream industry, especially the battery industry. Ya, karena itu tadi, battery industry kita itu akan membuat hilirisasi dari produk nikel kita itu mempunyai nilai tambah yang lebih jauh, lebih tinggi daripada hanya sekedar untuk produsen baja atau bahkan hanya ore-nya gitu, dalam biji nikel. Gitu. Nah, di kedepannya juga electric vehicle harus menjadi electric vehicle must become our main mode of transportation, including becoming the foundation of environmentally friendly transportation, which will also developed in Nusantara, ya, ibu kota baru Indonesia yang tenang. Kalau nanti mau invest di IKN Nusantara, itu semuanya mesti udah yang ekonomi apa ya, green vehicle ya, gitu ya. Ini Pak Presiden Jokowi. Jadi ini bentuk dukungannya. Ini target awal yang sesuai setelah perpres. Tapi jangan difoto dulu ya, nanti pakai slide berikutnya. Jadi yang berdasarkan itunya itu masih angkanya masih kecil. Jadi masih di tahun 2025 itu 1,76. Tetapi saya ngomong ini tapi sebenarnya enggak ada. Nah, di sini berdasarkan Permen Perin nomor 6 tahun 2022, targetnya itu dirubah semua. 2025 itu 6 juta. Logikanya, Pak, market kita sekarang, ICE-nya, internal combustion engine itu 6 juta. Ini bisa dicapai enggak? Kan enggak mungkin, Pak, ya. Sorry kalau ada orang pemerintah gitu ya. Tapi ini merupakan bentuk dari umbrella, dukungan invest, apa, supaya investor itu berani untuk invest di Indonesia terkait dengan kendaraan listrik. Jadi, betapa fokusnya pemerintah sampai market kita yang 6 juta pun di 2025 harus 6 jutanya listrik gitu kan. Nah, itu kita nggak usah ngomongin itu. Nah, total vehicle-nya yang ada di masyarakat ini sampai dengan bulan, kalau ini masih bulan Juli ya, ini di jimat 1 itu ada 54.000 populasi kendaraan listrik di Indonesia. Untuk two-wheeler, kalau total untuk sama busnya sama yang lain itu 72.000. Ini ya kira-kira. Nah, total merek yang ada itu sebenarnya saya tahu ya di yang pendaftaran SUT itu untuk two-wheeler itu ada 62 company ya. Walaupun nanti secara corporate-nya bisa, ini brand-nya, brand-nya ada 62, tetapi corporate-nya mungkin 42 karena ada satu company yang punya beberapa brand gitu ya. Nah, ini yang tadi year by year-nya gitu ya. EV two-wheeler nih tahun 2017 itu baru 32 gitu. Ini tumbuh di 2021 ke 2022 itu tumbuh 70%-an. Tapi tahun ini kita itu harapannya kurang lebih bisa tumbuh 200%. Walaupun itu juga enggak nyerap insentif yang ada gitu ya. Nanti kita lihat datanya. Ini sampai dengan bulan Juli mantumannya. Sekarang kan Oktober nih. Saya juga baru update untuk yang sampai dengan Oktober tanggal 23. Jadi sampai tahun ini aja udah 43.000. Ya. Kalau tahun lalu 17.000 gitu ya. Dikali 2 aja udah 34 ya. Ini masih ada 2 bulan ke depan. Jadi perkiraan kita memang untuk two-wheeler angkanya kecil tetapi masih growth di angka 200%-an gitu ya dibandingkan tahun lalu. Ini contoh-contoh yang populer gitu ya, bentuknya kayak gini-gini gitu ya. Nih kita swipe aja. Nah, tantangannya ya, tentunya di sini tantangan utama dari saya mending skip ya langsung ke resume aja nanti. Nah, di sini ada insentif. Untuk mempercepat itu pun pemerintah memberikan insentif yang 7 juta. Yang awalnya itu syaratnya ribet gitu ya, harus orang miskin lah segala macam gitu ya. Nah, sekarang itu udah di satu KTP satu gitu ya. Itu pun penyerapannya sampai ini yang sampai bulan dengan Juli ya gitu. Sampai hari ini saya tadi pagi ngecek gitu ya, kira-kira yang di sininya ini 6.000 proses pendaftaran, yang ininya kira-kira yang sudah tersalurkan itu 4.000, yang masih proses verifikasi itu 2.000. Jadi kurang lebih baru terpakai itu 12.000 dari 200.000 insentif kuota yang diberikan untuk tahun ini. Nah, di sini. Jadi kita ini kunci dari kendaraan listrik tadi adalah sebetulnya yang di awal tadi saya sampaikan belum bisa memenuhi kebutuhan masyarakat yang bisa dipakai kemana aja, kapan aja, karena ada lag di baterai. Baterai menjadi game changer karena baterai harganya kurang lebih ya itu 40% dari total cost dari vehicle-nya sendiri. Nah, kedua, charging time-nya. Charging time dari baterai saat ini yang ada gitu ya, yang ada banyak kan sekarang di Indonesia itu selain silit acid ada yang pakai lithium ferrofosfat dan ada yang NMC gitu ya. Tetapi banyak kan sekarang ini ngarahnya masih ke lithium ferrofosfat ya karena dianggap lebih major gitu ya. Nah, di situ rata-rata masih untuk 1,5 kWh itu mereka itu chargernya itu 300 watt lah. Jadi kira-kira masih butuh sekitar 5 jam kalau dari kosong gitu ya. Kalau dari 20% biasanya kan kita ada batasan untuk ngecas itu nggak boleh dari 20% SOC-nya, start of charge-nya gitu ya. Nah, di situ kira-kira 4 jaman gitu ya masih dibutuhkan waktu. Kan nggak mungkin, saya mau ke Bandung, jarak tempuhnya rata-rata 60 kilo, nyampe di Kerawang gitu ya, gua ngecas 4 jam gitu ya, baru lanjut ke Bandung gitu ya. Nah, solusinya ada namanya baterai swap gitu ya. Ada baterai swap, tetapi baterai swap itu kan mahal. Dari tempat kami ya, di asosiasi kami ada juga pernah ada project gitu ya, itu setidaknya untuk di perkotaan, satu vehicle, motor gitu ya, EV, itu harus di cover minimal 3 baterai di area yang sama. Gitu. Nah, padahal kontribusi dari baterai 40% dari harga kendaraan. Artinya kapitalisasi investment untuk baterainya itu lebih mahal daripada nilai jual dari kendaraannya itu sendiri. Itu menjadi lag dari investment itu. Makanya pemerintah sekarang ada proses untuk SNI 892728 ya, itu membuat kamenisasi dari baterainya. Tetapi tentu karena jumlahnya yang 62 merek tadi ya, itu bukan hal yang mudah untuk bisa menjadikan satu produk aman gitu ya. Sehingga waktu itu ada 48 volt, ada yang 60 volt, ada yang 72 volt gitu. Dari sini voltasenya aja. Nah, terus ada yang soketnya pun beda-beda. Berapa macam, ada 5 macam, segala macam. Ya tentu ada kelebihan dan kekurangan masing-masing. Nah, itu sekarang ini dalam proses SNI yang digalang dari Kemenperin bersama dengan SDM untuk bisa menjadikan common, tapi voluntary. Karena apa? Kita nggak bisa ninggal yang lain yang nggak bisa common gitu ya. Nah, itu sekarang dalam proses itu. Kira-kira baterai yang selalu jadi utamanya. Nah, kita ngomong untuk tahun depan gitu ya. Tahun depan ini 2024 kita ada beberapa faktor-faktor. Jadi inflasi kita itu untuk tahun 2003 ini kan udah ini seperti ini ya. Dari mantumannya gitu ya. Turun sampai di angka ini gitu ya. Nah, di sini juga ada inflasi ya, cukup terkendali juga gitu kan ya. Nah, Indonesia secara umum inflasi kita sampai dengan September itu 2,28% gitu ya. Dengan indeks harga konsumen masih cukup bagus gitu ya, 115,44. Terus prediksi inflasi di tahun 2023 itu 3 plus minus 1 gitu ya. Ya, dibandingkan dengan 2023 yang hampir 2 kali lipatnya gitu ya. Terus suku bunga bank di Indonesia dia kita akan sampai dengan Oktober ini kan 2,6% gitu ya. Nah, prediksi kita di 2024, sorry ini ya, yang ini, 2024 itu 2,5 sampai plus minus 1. Ini yang kita ambil dari sumber-sumber yang ada di BPS, dari BI, gitu ya, dari Setcap, dan juga dari IMF, gitu. Ini yang akan jadi acuan kita mengenai ini, gitu ya. Nah, secara ekonomi growth di Asia ini ya, dari tahun 2020, kita ngelihat ini ya, Vietnam cukup tinggi ya di 2022, gitu ya. Indonesia ada di 5,3%, gitu ya. Nah, untuk 2024, forecast kita kan 4,9. Nah, ini kita. Perkiraan sebelumnya di April itu kita juga bilang, jadi kita akan stabil di ekonomi growth kita lebih 4,9% sesuai dengan yang ada di sumber dari World Bank. Gitu. Nah, berdasarkan itu semua, gitu ya, tahun 2024 kita tidak menjanjikan tumbuh yang cukup tinggi, gitu ya. Perkiraan tahun ini prediksi ini proyeksi kita resmi tahun lalu itu 5,8 sampai 6 juta. Tetapi kemungkinan akan bisa kita close di 6,1 sampai 6,2. Nah, tahun depan kita akan ada di angka 6,2 sampai 6,5 juta gitu ya. Dengan beberapa faktor yang menentukannya, yang mendukung adalah stable-nya dari growth ekonominya kita 5 sampai 5,5% gitu ya. Inflasinya juga terkendali di 3 sampai 4%. Terus kita juga ada angka rupiah kita terhadap dolar juga akan ada di 15,5 sampai 16,2 ya, ribu gitu ya. Terus adanya kestabilan domestic consumption dan purchasing power gitu ya. Dan kita berharap bahwa general election 2024 juga akan aman-aman saja, stabil ya, tidak ada gejolak yang berarti gitu ya. Itu kita berdoa gitu ya. Nah, ada potensial growth di two wheeler market segment gitu ya. Dan juga di sini ada faktor bahwa finance company juga lebih prudent sih di sini untuk membalance antara profit dan share-nya gitu ya. Nah, faktor-faktor yang sedikit akan menahan gitu ya, itu adalah global economy slowdown gitu ya, supply chain risk impact dari geopolitik baik Ukraine itu maupun di Israel, di Gaza, segala macam yang ada di dunia itu juga akan memberikan tekanan terhadap pertumbuhan ekonomi. Ini yang bisa kami sampaikan untuk hari ini, semoga bermanfaat. Saya tahu bahwa hari ini acaranya mengenai manufacturing, cuma saya sedikit, di ujung manufacturingnya adalah marketnya. Marketnya mestinya yang menjadi acuan kita. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you. One more time, Q&A time. Yes. Very fast. Thank you so much. Oke, wah terima kasih Pak. Wih, menarik sekali ya nih. Pak, boleh nanya nih. Kan sekarang motor listrik kita banyak serbuan dari China ya, merek-merek banyak dari China. Apakah pemerintah Indonesia ada kebijakan untuk memproteksi merek-merek lokal kita kayak Honda yang memproduksi benar-benar, kan kita benar-benar produksi banget Pak semuanya di Indonesia. Nah, gimana biar kita tuh lebih diproteksi dibanding si serbuan merek-merek China ini? Karena kan mereka so many brands, udah gitu harganya murah-murah banget. Tapi kan mereka nggak produksi di sini.
Di dunia ini ada istilah Pak, kalau di ini ada istilahnya. Memang alam semesta ciptaan Tuhan, tetapi sisanya made in China itu realita. Itu common gitu ya. Jadi kita nggak bisa hindarin itu gitu ya. Memang alam semesta ciptaan Tuhan, tetapi lainnya itu made in China Pak sekarang. Udah susah Anda bergeming dari situ. Gitu. Nah, tapi gini, dari 62 tadi itu punya NIK, nomor VIN number-nya gitu ya. Artinya itu sebenarnya sudah ada proses industrialisasi di Indonesia walaupun dalam tahap paling minimal masih ada yang assembling. Saya tahu, karena saya dulu di Robert Bosch ya, ada banyak juga yang memang merek-merek lokal yang berkembang lebih dari hanya sekedar assembling. Tetapi ya tadi, dari 62 itu memang banyak kan ya assembling gitu ya. Tapi banyak yang bagus-bagus seperti, ya banyak lah, kita nggak nyebut merek gitu ya. Itu banyak juga yang memang itu. Dan Indonesia juga ada SNI-nya, Mas. Nanti ada SNI kita untuk bisa dikendarai di pasar. Itu harus lulus uji safety ya gitu ya. Yang di namanya itu uji tipe kendaraan di Kemenhub. Itu harus memenuhi syarat-syarat safety yang sudah ditetapkan yang merefer UNR 136 untuk roda 2, UNR 100 untuk yang roda 4. Itu diadop dari situ, artinya secara keselamatan segala macam itu sudah menjadi patron sehingga konsumen tidak dirugikan. Kalau terkait dengan lokal brand atau kita ada persyaratan TKDN, Pak, tingkat kandungan komponen dalam negerinya. Yang dapat insentif itu syaratnya 40% ke atas. Dan tidak mudah gitu ya. Ya, kira-kira komponen utama itu kontribusinya itu ada 50%, 30% baterai, komponen rangkanya 10%, lainnya itu 10%. Terus ada komponen pendukung, sistem-sistem yang di luar itu, komponen utama itu 10%. Terus di komponen aspek yang ketiga adalah assembly. Ada persyaratan NIK tadi kan, ada persyaratan. Harus punya pengelasan, harus punya pengecatan, harus punya assembling, ya, prosesnya, ya, perakitannya. Harus punya manajemen mutu, mengendalikan mutu. Nah, di situ ya. Nah, di situ kan sudah juga, kalau itu semua dipenuhi, itu akan dapat 20%. Nah, terakhir adalah aspek dari riset. Punya kontribusi 20% TKDN. Mulai dari riset pasar, sampai dia bikin apa namanya desain produknya, terus bagaimana bikin mock up-nya, ada sampai dengan dia pengujian dan sertifikasi. Itu juga punya 20% kalau dari sisi kegiatannya. Di R&D ada dua cara ngukurnya. Yang kedua adalah based on investment. Kalau investmentnya 30 miliar ke atas, 10 sampai 30 miliar dapat 10%. 5%, sorry. Yang 30 sampai 50 miliar dalam 3 tahun ke depan itu dapat 10%. Di atas 50 miliar investment dalam 3 tahun ke depannya di bidang R&D itu bisa dapat 20%. Jadi pemerintah membuat rencana TKDN khusus untuk kendaraan listrik roda 2 utamanya dengan cara itu tadi. Yang tahun ini harusnya 40% kan berdasarkan perpres, itu rencananya perpres akan direvisi, akan diperpanjang gitu ya. Bahwa 40% syarat itu akan, ini berdasarkan kita meeting dengan government gitu ya, itu akan diperpanjang sampai dengan Desember 2026 masih menggunakan skema 40%. Itu good news-nya. Cukup menjawab ya Mas Gatulnya. Itu bentuk-bentuk proteksi kita terhadap yang dari luar.
Alright, we have time for one more question.
Selamat siang Pak Ari.
Siang Pak.
Saya Michael Ciptadi dari Garuda Netarindo.
Oh iya Pak.
Pak mau tanya satu saja Pak.
Iya.
Itu tadi yang terkait dengan angka. Bapak sampaikan proyeksi 2023 6,1-6,2.
Iya, untuk domestic bank.
Domestic. Dan ya. 2024 juga itu kira-kira 6,2-6,5.
Iya.
Iya. Mau make sure saja Pak. Itu berarti angka adalah untuk wholesales, domestic CBU.
Jadi wholesale itu distribution.
Ya, betul.
Kalau kita ya.
Itu tadi angka wholesale.
Betul, ya, betul.
Kalau productionnya ada gambaran nggak, Pak?
Productionnya sebenarnya nanti ya. Kalau kami sudah mulai pegang, kira-kira 10%-nya itu untuk ekspor.
Ya.
Jadi domestiknya 6,2, 10%-nya ekspor untuk CBU. Nah, sedangkan sebenarnya angka ekspor CKD-nya kurang lebih itu setara dengan domestik kita, Pak, ekspornya, dalam unitnya.
Sorry, Pak. 10% maksudnya... 10%.
Jadi contohnya 6 juta ya, misalnya 6 juta. Itu 600 ribu sampai dengan 800 ribu itu ekspor CBU. Jadi 6,8 jadinya kan ya. Nah, ditambah 6 juta lagi itu ekspor dalam bentuk CKD, Pak, sebenarnya. Jadi size-nya gede banget, Pak.
CKD-nya 6 juta, Pak, bisa?
Oh, ya, senang nggak senang gitu ya. Saya tahu itu juga baru-baru ini, terutama di merek Y itu hampir 500 ribu CKD sebulan, Pak.
Oh gitu.
Ya. Okay. Memang selama ini nggak kita praktis.
CKD kalau di, tanya satu lagi, Pak. Kalau mereka bilang CKD itu kan selalu disebutnya satuannya set.
Ya.
Set itu bisa nggak? Saya asumsikan set itu satu motor.
Ya.
Oh bisa.
Ya, seperti itu.
Ya. Terima kasih, Pak.
Okay, one more time. Let's give a big applause to the speaker.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And before we continue with the other presentations, we will have our 30-minute coffee break. 30 minutes, right? Okay, 30-minute break. You will find refreshment at the right side of the hall, like yesterday. You are also free to visit booths at all of our business partners located at the foyer. This is your last chance to chat with them, so make sure you make the most from the networking and try to get to know one each other. If you need any help, I'll be there all the time. Find me. My name is Jack. When we return, we will have two more presentations before the lucky draw. So let's I'll be back in the conference after 30 minutes. Right now will be 10:36. So let's come back at 11. Okay, right 11. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
We will have four. We're ready. Well, I'll now announce the next question. We will have ladies and gentlemen, please come inside. Why? How come we have echo again? You know the study is always. Yeah, I'll invite everyone to come inside. Ladies and gentlemen, please come inside the conference room and please open my microphone volume. Yeah, open it. Yeah, good. Ladies and gentlemen, please come inside the conference room. Our next session will begin in 1 minute. What? Okay, let's wait for 1 minute. Okay, I'll ask my staff to ask him people to come inside. In the meantime, I'll give you the clicker.
Okay.
Yeah. You set the point later. All right, as people are coming back to the conference room, I would like to announce some notification for all of you. In the afternoon of today, after our sessions, maybe some of them already know that, we were going to have a factory tour. We're going to have a factory tour. And the factory tour, we have limited seats. So in the yesterday afternoon, many of them has registered already. We are full ready. However, we might have some people drop out today. So if you still want to go to the factory tour, you would like to be on the waiting list, please go to the registration desk and ask our staff to put your name in the list and meet us exactly at 1:15 at the gate of this hotel. The bus will be there waiting for us on time. So during then, you can see if we have extra empty seats for you to attend the factory tour, okay? You cannot drive your own cars, your own vehicles, and follow us go to the factory because we have to register the car plates. That's why who have actually registered yesterday for the factory tour, please be on time at 1:15 to 1:30. We will start at 1:30. So be there at 1:15 at the gate and follow me. Yeah, follow Jack or my staff, Ben, Catherine, and D2. All right, since everybody's coming back, I would like to start our next session when we're back to the presentations. Hello, everyone. We hope you have a good coffee break and got to know one another and have visited the booth as well. So let's get on to our presentations next. Our speaker is the sales director of BT Door System Indonesia and an improvement and innovation specialist on Industry 4.0. His field of enterprise includes solutions for digital factory, industrial planning system, air purification system, automotive assembly system, and equipment and factory manufacturing system. That's a lot. Let's go. Welcome, Franz Mandako. Woo!
Okay. Thank you very much for the welcoming speech. Okay, everyone. Yeah, I'm glad to be back here. Yeah, so long time.
Old friend.
Ringier. So I used to be speaking about the 4.0 with Ringier. Yeah, I attend several their seminars, but at the time I was with my previous company. So now I'm with Dure Indonesia. So if you know, Dure is a very, very famous automotive equipment supplier in the world. And now, and it's coming from Germany, it's perfect because my background education also coming from Germany. So I have missions in this company. I would love to transfer the technology. You know that we have a technology out there and we have to bring to Indonesia so we can improve our technology here. This is my missions. That's why I would love to share you all the technology that we have developed to answer the questions, how to become sustainable. So at the beginning, actually, what is... Okay. Yeah. What is sustainable, actually? Why this tema now become... It's gradually becoming trends in Indonesia. So sustainability. It's maybe if one of you watching the launch of iPhone 15, launching iPhone 15, 15, itu ada dibahas tentang sustainability. Mereka they are very highlighting about the sustainability. And you know why they are focusing so much? Maybe we can see also the trends. Yeah, it's not only Apple, but also the BMW, the Mercedes, even some of our customers in Indonesia began to asking us regarding the sustainability. Can you help us to make our factory become sustainable? I'm very surprised. Yeah. Is this because of the launch of iPhone 15? Why you are now getting considered to have this kind of sustainability in your factory? Because, you know, and I see actually some of research, yeah, I don't put here because this is not our slides. There are some research that people define if the consumer sees the product as a sustainability story, they want to pay more. So, like, you know, if this is actually also become a branding activity, yeah. As we know from the slides from IC before, right, Pak Hari before, our president, Pak Jokowi, dia promote IKN kan. IKN-nya itu dia promote dengan tema our national capital will become the greenest capital in the world. It means what? He trying to promote our country with a sustainability theme. He want to brand Indonesia as a sustainable country. That's why he trying to bring the EV. He trying to make this Nusantara because he want to brand our nations become sustainable. Why? Because the issue of sustainability is a world issue and it's become up now after the pandemics. As we know, our clouds in Indonesia is very dirty, right? So yeah. Nowadays, this theme is going up. And if we know, we can use this also to promote our brands. So what is actually sustainable? Sustainable, we can see sustainable in three different categories. Of course, economic. Because of the pandemic, we see that a lot of company has a struggle to maintain their business, right? So it becomes sustainable. It means you are more able to face the crisis. You have more survival ability in financial situation. How we do that? How we achieve these things? How we achieve this thing? It means we have to eliminate any possible cost that not a fixed cost, yeah, but a sudden cost like that we unexpected cost. We have to eliminate this kind of thing. So we have to reduce the maintenance cost of our facility, right? And the second thing is the operational cost. If we have a lower operational cost, we are more sustainable because we have more profit, we have more buffer like that. That is sustainability from the financial way. For environmental, you know already, I don't have to explain for everyone knows about this. So that's why the sustainability topics is now becoming pressing. And actually, in our company, in Germany, people already concerned regarding this kind of issue from 10 years ago. But you know that Indonesia is always a bit late, like the 4.0 issue also Indonesia in out there is only start from 20, 30 years ago. But we just recently started since around 5 to 10 years ago. So like all the trends is coming a bit late, but now it's become more people become aware and try to implement that. So this is what I explained to you that some of our customers, which is OEM, already began asking for us, not only in Germany, not only in China. In China, this issue of sustainability is already very strong, because they even push all the manufacturer in China to use water-based paint, which is here is uncommon. But in China, they push for the water-based paint. Why? Because it's also sustainably environmental issue. So who are we? Sure, we are from 125 years ago. We already specialize in automotive industry. So since 1896, of course, I haven't born yet. So Dürr has three divisions for the paint industry, for automotive industry, but we also have a HOMA who are specialists wood cutting industry and also Sheng with the balancing industry. So this is the facts of our company. 60% of all paint shops and 50% of final assembly lines in the whole world was equipped with our facility. But yeah. So we supply not only the paint shops, as you know, but we also supply for the equipment for the assembly of the cars. So conveyors and also inspection, like filling machines, checking for the brakes, everything is also in our portfolio, so we can supply the whole, basically, if you want to build a factory. So this is our history here in Indonesia. Actually, you are already here in 1983 in Dirgantara, Indonesia, in IPTN. Before, we are supporting the airplane industry. I was surprised to see this machine as well, when I visited there. Oh, we know Dürr already. How could you know Dürr? We have the machine. when you buy it, and I saw the machines, there are three kinds of machines over there, and it's built before I was born. So we also in Indonesia, we have three facilities, one in Gaya Motor, one in PT Handal, was built in 1992. Actually, that is the first Indonesian company in the beginning of Indonesian industry of automotive was helped by Dunga. So when Gaya Motor was started its business in before, right, 1992, they purchased our equipment. And the second line is becoming the first line of Daihatsu. So nowadays, we have several companies that become our customers. Yeah? So now back to the sustainability story. So how you can achieve this sustainability? How we can help you for, yeah, actually how, this is what I share the technology. So with, yeah, of course, this is what you, we can help you for the voltage, but we can help you for the digitalizations, for the plan assessment. We have the sustainable product that I want to show you. We try to give you the best, like how we can do the retrofit like that. We help you with the layout. So what kind of things that we can improve actually, like, yeah, this is all the things that we have to focus when we want to achieve a sustainability. So in the vehicle factory, which part is have the potential to have improvement to become sustainable? If we see from total vehicle production, actually the energy demand of our is one facility, the most of it was coming from the paint shop, and also the most costly one. So if you want to build a car factory, the most expensive thing from this factory actually the paint shop, and it takes also the most energy there. Yeah? And inside of the paint shop, the most energy was taken by spray wood. So if we can reduce the energy in spray wood, if we can reduce the energy in engines, we can reduce the total consumption of energy of one car factory alone. So if we can reduce the consumption from 20%, yeah, so if we can reduce for 27%, then we can reduce the 10% of total energy demand of engine. So the effect is very strong. That's why to become sustainable, the first thing is how do you optimize your paint shops. Of course, Indonesia. So how to do it? This is the technology that we I want to show you, that we want to introduce a dry scrubber system. This is actually not new, yeah. For all of you who knows about the painting, there's a lot of dry scrubber out there who normally using a paper filter. But the weakness of this paper filter is actually, yeah, you cannot catch all the VOC. So basically there's still paint. And the paint is still going out to the roof or somewhere else and to go to the outside area. So basically, it's not that environmental friendly if you are using the old technology of dry scrubber. But dry scrubber has definitely already more energy saving. Why? How could we can save the energy cost of dry scrubber? You know, to paint the cars, we have to keep a certain conditions in the paint booth. For example, the temperature, the humidity, we have to put in some range. Even if you want to apply water-based paint later on, the requirement will be much stricter. And nowadays, normally in the old paint booth in Indonesia, they paint with the water-based, wet separation paint booth. Yeah? So they paint in the paint booth, if they're spraying the paint will stick to the water. They use water, like water curtain to throw the rest of the paint away. Yeah, the weakness of this technology is first, the air inside is become humid. So you after because we have to keep a certain level of the humidity and temperature, you have to throw away the air inside of the spray booth, and you have to keep getting new air from outside, and it costs you a lot of energy. Why? Because the chiller will working so high, the heater also working so high to set up the dew point and the dryness. So if we don't use water in the paint shop, we can circulate the air because the air is not that humid and the condition already met. But there's one requirement. So in order to achieve the most efficient way, we have to use robot. Why? We have to use robot because this recirculation air is not a fresh air. So it's not, for a human, it's not perfect. If there's a people who still working with the hands, so we have to use a fresh air. We cannot use the recirculation. So that's why I want to inform you, in order to achieve this improvement, we have to use the newest technology, the digitalization sama robot. Okay, jadi bagaimana sih, seperti apa sih sebenarnya dry scrubber itu? I have some movies, maybe you can see. This is the newest filter that we have. So we don't use the paper filter anymore, but we use carbon box filter ya. Jadi bisa lihat, ini angin udaranya akan diresirkulasi. So this is new technology, but it will not, ini gak bakalan, ini bahkan datang ke Indonesia. Sudah ada beberapa yang akan pasang. Jadi ini bukan teknologi baru, referensinya akan ada, dan mungkin akan jadi tren ke depan. Kenapa? Karena mengurangi investasi sangat banyak, nggak usah pakai air kan, berarti kita mengurangi konsumsi air, di mana itu yang biayanya lumayan besar, dan itu juga pengaruh isu lingkungan. Jadi, terus juga dirimu, kalian bisa buat pabriknya di mana aja. Kenapa? Karena nggak perlu ada buat WWT kan, nggak perlu pembuangan limbah, nggak perlu nyari sumber air, dirinya bisa di mana aja, jadi lebih fleksibel. Why we call this flexibility for sustainability. Jadi kalau ada full, nanti bisa di awan mana yang full, terus diganti. Nah, limbahnya ini, boxnya ini, kalau sekarang kan jadi limbah B3 dibuang. Karena dia bentuknya yang kasus, dia jadi dry. Ini bisa jadi buat bahan bakar untuk boiler. Jadi bisa dijual ke pembangkit listrik atau pabrik-pabrik yang punya boiler kayak Mulia Keramik. Ya, jadi kan harusnya ini lebih sustainable. Kenapa? Karena limbahnya bisa dijual lagi dan bisa dibakar jadi bahan bakar. Jadi kalau bapak-bapak lihat ini sudah lebih sustainable. Nah, ini kalau kita lihat di China, semua plant yang baru sekarang sudah memakai teknologi ini. Jadi sudah tidak ada yang pakai water base lagi. Semua sudah tidak ada pabrik mobil yang menggunakan wet rubber ya. Dan karena ini box kecil, jadi kita bisa supply untuk yang bandwidth kecil maupun bandwidth besar. Jadi bisa scalability juga. Nah, terus gimana cara mengurangi lagi energinya? We can reduce even more to from 40% to 25%. Jadi kita bisa kurangin lagi. We can even more reduce the energy consumption for the paint boy. How? Seperti saya tadi bilang, ini hanya bisa di achieve kalau semuanya satu sistem. Ini keuntungan kenapa DUR ada. Karena kalau Anda tahu yang lainnya. Jadi kita punya namanya Eco Pro Boot. Here we can reduce even more for 40% to 35% energy consumption. Why? Because if we use here total robot and no manpower walk around, it means we only have to send the fresh air to this corner. So all of here in the center is using recirculated air, and only the fresh air, the column for the manpower. So we can very, very minimize the consumption of the fresh air, because fresh air is very costly. And if manpower there, we don't need to keep the humidity, we don't need to keep the temperature, we don't need to keep really the temperature. So that's why this solution can reduce even more energy consumption with the directly fresh. So if you can see, classic wet separations, and with the EcoPro group, we can even reduce 75% the energy consumption. And it all costs, semuanya itu biaya. Kenapa? Karena kalau konsumsinya kecil, heaternya lebih kecil, chillernya lebih kecil, spare partnya harus lebih murah. Motornya lebih kecil, nggak ada pompa untuk air lagi, spare part akan jauh lebih murah, mengurangi biaya maintenance, dan itu yang namanya jadi sustainable. Lebih bisa sustainable karena mengurangi resiko-resiko yang ada. Nah, ini juga, nah sekarang kita masuk ke flexibility. Now we are entering the flexibility. After we try to make it sustain, and now how to improve to become more sustain. The reason is flexibility. Why? Because, you know, sekarang customer-customer di Indonesia, masyarakat di Indonesia, begitu ada brand baru, dia beli. Ada model baru, dia beli. Tidak ada yang loyal. Customer Indonesia tidak ada yang loyal. Jadi mereka akan suka model apa. Akibatnya apa? Pabrik-pabrik itu punya challenge di mana mereka harus mengganti modelnya setiap saat. Nah kita, saya kan dulu di manufacturing ya, kita begitu invest satu jalur, ya satu model itu aja. Nah, begitu tahu-tahu si makernya minta, kita mesti ganti model nih. Ini gimana cara gantinya ya? Berarti kan kita mesti ganti jig-nya, ganti semuanya. Nah, ini yang harus berubah konsep ini. Fixed production itu harus berubah jadi flexible production. Jadi satu line produksi harus ready dengan apapun perubahan yang diminta oleh konsumen. Jadi pabrik harus ready, harus bisa fleksibel dengan permintaan konsumen kalau mau cepat. Makanya sekarang teknologi yang baru, satu boot bisa buat beberapa jenis mobil. Mau besar, mau kecil, bisa dikerjakan di tempat yang sama. Dan ini misalnya konsep. Ini yang di Indonesia rata-rata seperti ini. Jadi jalur produksinya satu jalur untuk 60 mobil per jam ya, contohnya. Dan ini bisa dirubah, kita bagi dengan jadi kecil-kecil. Jadi dari yang tadinya satu jalur panjang, jadi jalur kecil-kecil. Tujuannya apa? Kalau ternyata produksinya berkurang, bisa matiin salah satu, cuma satu aja yang nyalain. Atau misalnya, ada model ini, bisa satu-satu. Jadi, tapi konsep ini cuma bisa tercapai kalau apa? Kalau boot-nya itu fleksibel. Jadi kita mesti dari awal konsepnya udah harus seperti sana. Dan ini this is our strong point ya, SSDR1, because all the robot made indoor, all the paint shop made indoor, all the automizer made indoor, the electrical, the program, the digitalisasi made indoor. Artinya apa? Integrasinya buat kita jauh lebih mudah dibandingkan perusahaan-perusahaan lain yang kawinkan berbagai macam merek. Ini yang paling penting. Ini cuma bisa tercapai kalau ada sinergi dari semua equipmentnya dan bisa di-research bareng-bareng. Dan ini makanya teknologi yang ada di luar sana yang pengen saya share, pengen kita bawa ke Indonesia supaya Indonesia itu bisa lebih survive. Karena kalau buat pabrik mobil, jadi kalau bawa minggu ini buat invest pabrik mobil ya, sekarang investasi bisa lebih mudah dan konsumsi bisa lebih mudah, lebih murah. Oke, jadi sekarang kita lihat bagaimana sih istilahnya pabrik mobil di masa depan seperti apa, teknologi apa lagi bisa kita lihat dari flexibility.
Massive and anything but space saving. Once it's built, the layout of a classic paint shop can only be changed at a great expense. Our answer to this is the paint shop of the future. It stands for modularity, flexibility, and scalability. Efficient, sustainable, and fully digitalized. To achieve this, we first put all the components on how they work together in terms of process, size, consumption, and performance to the test. Our changes are at the heart of the paint job. We've replaced rigid lines with a flexible box concept in the paint booth. This means that the wide variety of products lower our tool doesn't have to set the pace.
Formula that scalability
interior and exterior painting in just one painting, equally equipped for both base coat and layer coat. The EcoGlove 4 Pro Max Universal Atomizer is a real all-rounder. Now it's great for interiors, white ones for exteriors, even the metallic paints are possible.
Jadi di robotnya tinggal pengetahuan RFID, jadi dia bisa lihat sendiri kemana, terus dia tinggal ganti kalau pakai warna ini. Ini malah nggak ada overspray sama sekali. Jadi cara kayak digital yang terjadi printing.
Efficiency meaning 100% less waste, 30% lower VOC emissions, and 30% less energy consumption.
Ini nggak perlu paint booth ya, karena nggak ada
overspray. For pre-treatment too, we go up instead of out. The EcoPro Web PT system, plus instead of this, the force of water cleans the car body. EcoSeal Jet Pro bridges to the final gap of automation when it comes to heating and sealing. Extremely precise and sustainable. State-of-the-art ovens are truly electrifying. The EcoWinter is not only immersive in how it drives electric vehicles, it can also be operated electrically.
Jadi biasanya di oven kan mobilnya berjajar ya. Jadi sekarang vertikal.
The paint shop of the future is always making improvements. Through planning based on artificial intelligence, we can optimize throughput times. We evaluate normalities and anomalies and adjust production accordingly. Together with machine learning and our system process expertise, we ensure more availability, higher quality, and better performance.
It's very important for our partners.
The paint shop of the future is our promise. We help shape the future. This requires sustainable strategies that we've already implemented. Our COG neutral paint shop is already reality, one that complies with all perfectly valid and planned VOC limits. We tear down rigid lines for a completely new layout. The layout of the paint shop of the future. Flexible, scalable, compact.
Okay, so all of our video are available in YouTube. So if you want to see it again, there is in YouTube. Just find our channel. So so it's why now I want to summarize what I inform you. So sustainability in our factory, we can only achieve if we can combine all the newest technology with the digitalization. And we can help you to achieve that if you require. Okay, then thank you very much if you have some questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mm-hmm. Now, open forum, question time. I love the video, by the way. That's lovely. And yes, it's on the YouTube, so everyone wants to watch again?
Yes,
just
yes.
Just go to YouTube. Okay, questions first. We can open for one more.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Thank you for your good presentation. So about the sustainability, I think all the company in Indonesia also facing the same requirement for improving our sustainability. Unfortunately, in my company, maybe most of the other companies, the cost will increase about 30%. How do you overcome the cost of the compliance to the sustainability?
The cost of of water, the cost of electricity, you mean?
Cost per unit. Painting cost.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. That's why.
Cost per unit to be increased 30% to apply the sustainability, right? You have to have the title, the other. How do you overcome this?
Okay. So this is based on my real experience. Because of this new technology, we can actually, the investment, it's not we can reduce the investment cost actually, because everyone knows dude, it's expensive. Yeah. it's clear we are one of the top tier of the supplier, so it's expensive. But actually, if we compare to the wet and dry, for example, yeah, the investment cost can be less. Why? Because we can reduce the size of the pump, we can reduce the size of the chiller, we can reduce the size of the burner, we can reduce the size of the boilers. So with this efficiency, and if you see also the structure of the paint booth was not so complex as the water one, the wet one. So we can reduce also the cost of making the booth. So it's so instead to purchase this kind of equipment, we can reduce a lot the yeah, but of course now you have to buy the boxes, right? You have to buy the boxes now. But of course, the cost of the box and the cost of the improvement. At the end, I try to simulate. Actually, we can reduce around our predictions. Yeah, around 15%. So we can reduce the cost per unit by 15%. That is what we internally calculated, but it's not confirmed yet. Yeah, I don't want to say this as a justification. Okay, any other questions? Maybe
I think it's about time. Yeah, and we have
okay.
one question.
Okay, okay.
Mm-hmm. So thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Okay,
I'd like to welcome the next session of the speaker. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Now, please wait for me for a moment. I will start first. And then.
Yes.
Here.
Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the very informative presentation a while ago. Before we move to the next presentation, we would like to remind those who registered for the visit to the Toyota Indonesia Academy today that the vehicle will leave it exactly at 1:30. So please be at the lobby of the hotel by 1:15. You will see our team members with a sign for those who register but not be able to join. Please inform us. Secretariat. And also, I mentioned a while ago, please go to the our resident desk to fill in your name in the waiting list if you want to go. Our next speaker is the chairman of the Indonesia ISO Expert Association, IIEA, a private management consulting company that was established in 2019 by a group of ISO experts in Indonesia. To tell us more about the changing customer demands and market trends, let's all welcome Novian Amaraputra.
Welcome.
Yes.
Thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam Om Swastiastu, Nama Budaya, dan salam sehat selalu untuk teman-teman. First of all, I need to talk about in bahasa Malaysia, is it okay? Okay. Ini udah siang soalnya, jadi mudah-mudahan teman-teman belum kelaparan dan masih ada waktu. How long my time? How far?
25 minutes.
25 minutes, okay. I will try to speed up my material. Okay. This is the presentation. Before I will talk about IIEA first. IIEA is Indonesia ISO Expert Association. We are as the association to cover the 2% cover regarding the standardization. So IEA adalah gabungan dari para auditor ISO, kemudian juga para dari konsultan ISO, para trainer ISO, dan para implementer. Implementernya adalah yang perusahaan-perusahaan yang menjalankan ISO, mereka mungkin ada fungsi MR, internal audit, mengendali dokumen, dan lain-lain. Itu juga join di kita. Dan para observer. Observer ini bisa datang dari pemerintahan maupun dari pihak-pihak lainnya. Dan yang paling kita kejar adalah para newbie. Newbie ini adalah teman-teman atau adik-adik kita di pendidikan yang masih kuliah atau mungkin masih SMA, mereka harus tahu bahwa ada skema namanya para pemerhati standarisasi. Karena sampai hari ini masih jarang orang yang punya cita-cita pengen jadi auditor ISO. Jadi konsultan ISO itu kayaknya nggak ada cita-citanya seperti itu. Ya, mungkin ada beberapa teman yang saya lihat di sini adalah konsultan ISO. Kayaknya kok jarang gitu ya, konsultan ISO itu menjadi cita-cita. Nah, kita para pemerhati ISO ingin menggalang ya, sampai ke adik-adik kita bahwa itu adalah sebuah profesi yang luar biasa. Mudah-mudahan profesinya banyak pahalanya. Sepakat ya Pak Malik ya, karena memberikan inputan yang luar biasa ke perusahaan untuk bisa selalu improve, mereka baik dari waktu ke waktu. Kami baru hadir di tahun 2019 akhir, 2019 akhir, jadi belum lama, hari tahun ini adalah tahun keempat kita jalan asosiasinya, tapi peminatnya cukup banyak, hampir 3.000 orang yang daftar ke kami untuk bisa bergabung di Asosiasi Indonesia ISO Expert Asosiasi. Kita mengcover sampai dengan 12 provinsi. Nah, teman-teman yang belum bergabung, maka silakan bergabung ke Indonesia ISO Expert Asosiasi. Sekali saya ulang, para pemerhati standarisasi di Indonesia. Nah, ini ada barcode-nya, teman-teman yang tertarik untuk join, silakan di foto barcode-nya dan silakan mengisi datanya, nanti kita akan validasi. Mudah-mudahan IEA akan lebih baik dengan dukungan teman-teman semua. Ya. Welcome and join to Indonesia ISO Expert Association. Oke, sudah di foto? Oke, nah saya akan bahas mengenai judulnya mungkin agak sedikit menantang. Ya. Kenapa sih market trend, kemudian ekspektasi market itu berubah? Dan bagaimana kita selaku pelaku industri untuk menghadapi? Ya. Kita akan bahas ini topiknya kurang lebih 27 menit ke depan ya. Nah, salah satunya kenapa sih berubah? Ya, kenapa sih setiap waktu berubah? Ya. Apapun standarnya, ya kita refer ke agama mungkin ya. Agama juga berbicara kalau kita tetap tidak berubah katanya mati gitu. Atau rugi. Ya, kalau kita enggak berubah itu katanya rugi. Ya, jadi kita harus melakukan perubahan. Nah, di industri juga sama. Ya, mereka melakukan perubahan yang luar biasa. Nah, kenapa berubah? Banyak sekali alasan. Ya, salah satunya mungkin yang bikin kita berubah seperti pandemi yang kemarin. Teman-teman ngerasain ya, pandemi berarti 2-3 tahun ya hampir ya, 2019 kemarin baru selesai, kita syukuri ya. Sekarang masih ada yang pakai masker? Masih ada ya, 1-2 masih. Saya juga kadang-kadang kalau di pesawat masih pakai masker. Tapi itu perubahan yang luar biasa. Per hari ini saya masih ngantongi masker. Kapan saya pakai? Lihat situasi, kondisi. Itu kan merubah kita ya. Dulu-dulu mungkin sebelum 3 tahun lalu, orang nggak ada yang ngantongin masker. Sepakat ya. Saya lihat di belakang masih ada bapak yang pakai masker. Masih pakai ya Pak ya? Luar biasa. Ya. Saya pakai masker kalau apa? Ke masjid saya masih pakai masker. Sholat Jumatan saya masih pakai masker. Kenapa? Ya nggak hanya COVID. Mungkin ada yang influenza, ada yang flu, dan lain-lain. Masa nutup hidung pada saat sholat kan sulit. Mendingan dari awal saya sudah gunakan masker. Ini tren perubahan. Sepakat ya teman-teman. Industri tentunya berubah totally ya. Nah ini yang kita lihat ya. Salah satunya adalah yang merubah itu pandemi. Teman-teman sekarang sebagian hibrid. Benar ya Pak Malik? Sebagian nonton lewat YouTube. Kapan mulainya? Salah satu pemicunya adalah pandemi. Ya, isu pandemi ini luar biasa. Kemudian sekarang meeting. Ya, salah satunya tapi ada efek negatif juga ya. Kebetulan saya biasanya ada annual meeting di UK karena kebetulan kantor pusat saya di UK. Sekarang setelah COVID nggak pernah ada tuh. Ya. Kemarin ada annual meeting via Zoom semua, via hybrid. Jadi nggak ada yang kumpul-kumpul lagi ya. Salah satunya mungkin yang berubah masalah meeting ya. Nah, termasuk pembelian. Teman-teman mungkin udah berubah. Yang tadinya gaptek, yang tadinya di handphone yang nggak ada aplikasi-aplikasi untuk membeli sesuatu, sekarang hampir semua orang punya. Mohon maaf, pembantu saya aja pakai aplikasi sekarang belanja sesuatu. Ya, ini salah satu pemicu. Jadi tren itu salah satu pemicunya adalah perubahan karena global event atau sebuah pandemi. COVID memberi kita pelajaran yang sangat berharga. Salah satu perubahannya adalah metode pertemuan, kemudian metode dua adalah metode transaksional atau e-commerce. Kemudian yang kedua terkait dengan economic kondisi, ya. Kalau kita lihat trennya terkait pengangguran, inflasi, tingkat pendapatan, itu juga mempengaruhi nilai beli, ya, cara orang berbelanja dan lain-lain. Ya, ini salah satu parameter yang berubah, yaitu terkait dengan kondisi ekonomi. Kemudian terkait dengan tren pasar yang berkembang, ya. Kalau kita lihat atau perhatikan, tren itu berubah-berubah, ya. Sekali sekarang kita lihat yang paling signifikan adalah online base, ya. Kemudian yang kedua kita lihat semua orang sekarang udah menggunakan online taksi dan lain-lain. Even yang seperti yang pemain lama pun Bluebird gitu ya, sekarang pun ordernya semuanya by order. Jarang yang Bluebird menggunakan tradisional konsep, ya. Jadi tren perkembangan ini juga terjadi di mana. Dan yang paling signifikan itu adalah nomor 4. Ya, kalau teman-teman cermati, kenapa sih ada perubahan? Karena ada peraturan atau kebijakan yang berubah. Ya. Jadi ketika ada peraturan harus green product, harus sesuatu yang semuanya sifatnya green, ya. Sekarang lagi fokus ke ESG, ya. Semua orang kiblatnya ke ESG, semua orang bikin laporan sustainability report dan lain-lain. Karena tren berubah, ya. Dulu orang bilang perusahaan yang bagus itu yang profitnya besar. Setuju ya? Sepakat ya, Bapak? Sekarang enggak. Ya. Sekarang parameternya kalau kita lihat dari annual report, yang paling utama itu berapa besar yang dia bisa sumbangsikan ke orang lain. Itu yang diplototin. Investor melihat itu. Berapa besar dia bisa impact ke green environment. Isu-isunya itu. Makanya kalau teman-teman lihat di sustainability report, ya, item yang paling signifikan, yang paling dicermati, ya bicaranya betapa ramah kita dengan lingkungan kita ini, ya, planet kita ini. Itu yang lebih utama. Sekali lagi, peraturan dan kebijakan juga berubah. Kemudian, yang berubah adalah terkait dengan nomor 6, ya, tekanan pasar. Tekanan pasar ini biasanya kompetitor. Kompetitor pastinya nggak tinggal diam. Ya, kita harus selalu check and recheck terkait dengan kompetitor. Nanti kita akan bahas. Ya. Kenapa sih kompetitor yang harus kita pelihara? Supaya kita juga berubah. Ya. Supaya kita tahu kondisi kita. Apakah kita di bawah atau sama atau di atas kompetitor kita. Kita harus tahu kondisi tersebut. Nah, ini yang disebut dengan tekanan yang sifatnya kompetitif. Ya. Kemudian nomor 7. Ya. Terkait dengan teknologi, ya, ini hal yang utama sekarang. Jangan tolak teknologi. Dulu saya punya teman, dia nggak mau pakai WhatsApp. Menurut dia WhatsApp itu nggak aman. Dia seorang cyber security person. Menurut dia WhatsApp itu nggak aman. Kalau mau pakai Messenger, katanya pakai Telegram. Ya, saya bilang orang semua pakai WhatsApp. Dia bilang berkeras dia nggak akan gunakan WhatsApp sampai kapan. Per hari ini dia nggak bisa hidup dan menggunakan WhatsApp. Ya, dia menggunakan WhatsApp. Teman-teman coba cek, satu kirim pakai email, satu kirim pakai WhatsApp. Yang mana yang dibaca? WhatsApp. Ya, kalau mau WhatsApp itu menjelaskan bahwa aku udah kirim email, tetap aja di WhatsApp. Ya, seorang owner perusahaan, ya, di email. Email itu formality bahwa tugasnya udah dijalankan, udah di emailkan, Pak. Tapi tetap aja dia akan kirim. Ya, email udah dikirimkan tanggal sekian. Pakai apa? Pakai WhatsApp. Ya, Messenger. Nah, ada seorang teman saya menolak WhatsApp karena alasan security. Ya, dia berkeras untuk Telegram lebih aman. Per hari ini dia adalah pelanggan WhatsApp, ya, bisnis dan semua fasilitas WhatsApp dia beli. Ya, dia gunakan. Ya. Jadi kita nggak bisa tolak teknologi. Ya, tetap harus akomodir. Beda dengan teman-teman kita yang di China ya. China strict to the point, dia tidak menggunakan WhatsApp. Ada teman-teman, mereka gunakan WeChat. Kenapa? Ya, alasan negara mereka. Ya. Tapi teman saya yang di luar, Pak, kalau keluar, dia download WhatsApp. Ya. Kantor kita salah satunya di Shanghai. Teman-teman saya yang di Shanghai, kalau meeting ke Jakarta, download WhatsApp. Ya. Jadi sekali lagi, teknologi nggak bisa ditolak. Ya. Next, yang terkait dengan gangguan teknologi atau disruption. Ya. Kita harus tahu dan kita harus kuat. Sekarang tren sertifikasi ISO, nanti mungkin Pak Malik bisa jelaskan. Salah satu yang paling banyak dipilih orang untuk penerapan ISO adalah ISO 27000. Ya, terkait dengan IT security. Kenapa orang menerapkan? Setelah COVID kemarin, semua badan sertifikasi, semua konsultan, ya bisnisnya naik di ISO 27000. Semua orang berlomba-lomba untuk mengamankan data. Ya. Kalau dulu sebelum COVID semuanya offline. Setelah COVID mau nggak mau mereka masuk ke online. Hati-hati perusahaan-perusahaan yang tidak aman secara data. Ya. Jadi tren sertifikasi sekarang, tren konsultasi salah satunya di ISO 27000. Itu salah satu perubahan. Nanti tanya ke Pak Malik. Pak Malik ini pakar 37.000. Kemarin yang udah bicara ya Pak Malik ya. Ya. Berdiri mungkin Pak Malik. Ya. Pak Malik berdiri biar yang lain tahu. Oke. Okay. Beliau pakar 37.000. Di pemerintahan sekarang konsepnya di 37.000 teman-teman. Anti penyuapan. Ya. Kenapa? Kemarin katanya Pak Erick Thohir mewajibkan semua BUMN karena kebetulan dia Menteri BUMN agar BUMN menggunakan ISO 37000. Harapannya apa? Ya. Biaya tinggi yang sering terjadi di pemerintahan kita mudah-mudahan bisa dihilang. Tapi beliau terpukul. Yang terpukul dengan hasil yang dikeluarkan oleh teman-teman dari Transparansi Internasional. Ya. Nilai kita jeblok. Elek bahasa Jerman. Ya. Itu sangat terpukul sekali. Kemudian setiap tahun nilai itu akan keluar. Tahun ini akan keluar, saya yakin tahunnya ini akan lebih jelek. Dan tahun depan adalah tahun politik. Ya, teman-teman tahu tahun politik? Dan biasanya akan lebih jeblok lagi. Jadi kemarin itu sebenarnya Pak Erick Thohir agak pasrah dengan nilai hasil indeks corruption kita yang jeblok. Tapi tren di sana mudah-mudahan berubah ya di pemerintahan. Kita berharap di swasta khususnya mudah-mudahan terkait dengan biaya-biaya tinggi yang terjadi karena suap penyuap itu bisa dihilangkan. Ya, kita sepakat mudah-mudahan dengan implementasi 37.000 yang dominan di pemerintahan itu bisa dihilangkan. Terakhir, poin bawah, environmental consent. Nah, ini yang bicara tadi, green product, sustainability dan lain-lain. Ya, ini tren ke depan, mau enggak mau. Ya. Orang udah bicara ESG, ESG di manapun orang bicara ESG. Sekarang Kadin lagi fokus ke ESG, lagi fokus ke karbon. Ya, pabrik-pabrik yang mengerjakan apapun, sekarang kita sarankan untuk jadi PDG, pedagang karbon. Sayang, ya, kita bisa kok jadi transaksional. Saya punya klien kemarin, saya kunjungi, ada teman-teman Unilever sini? Kemarin saya ke Unilever, Unilever itu ada 7 pabrik di Indonesia. Per hari ini dia belum fokus ke jualan karbon. Saya bilang, oh, dengan 7 pabrik itu jadi pedagang karbon itu luar biasa. Ya, teman-teman yang 1-2 pabrik aja kalau fokus ke karbon itu dagangan karbonnya luar biasa. Sepakat ya Pak ya? Apalagi kalau teman-teman punya 7 pabrik. Nah sekarang tren ke depan itu larinya mulai ke karbon. Ya, jadi teman-teman silakan pelajari terkait dengan karbonisasi, perdagangan karbon dan lain-lain. Karena ini bicara tren ke depan. Ini yang harus berubah. Ya, salah satunya terkait dengan environmental issue atau environmental concern. Nah, bagaimana kita mengadjustnya supaya bisa fulfill harapan dari customer kita atau dari marketer? Ada beberapa langkah yang harus kita lakukan. Ya, ini cepat saja. Pertama, lakukan market research.
kalau kita nggak pintar atau sulit atau kita nggak ada background untuk melakukan market research, gunakan pihak ketiga. Banyak sekali konsultan di luar ya bisa melakukan market research. Cari tahu customer itu need-nya apa sih per hari ini. Ada di ISO kan dijelasin ada need dan ekspektasi. Ya, need itu keinginan sekarang, ekspektasi itu harapan. Sekarang tuh harapan itu bergeser. Mereka itu mengharapkan harapannya itu terrealisasi sekarang, bukan hanya need-nya saja. Ya. Jadi udah bergeser ke harapan. Gimana cara kita memenuhinya? Lakukan market research, ya. Gimana caranya? Macam-macam, ya. Paling gampang gunakan. Thank you. Ya. Dan gabung ke focus group, ikutan asosiasi dan lain-lain ya untuk tahu market demand itu seperti apa. Ya. Jangan malas ya kalau ada tim sales. Sekarang itu rata-rata tim sales itu dijeburkan ke organisasi. Masukkan ke organisasi A, organisasi B, organisasi C. Supaya tahu market needs itu apa. Ya. Jangan ngumpulnya dengan sesama sales. Ya. Cemplungin mereka. Joinkan mereka ke asosiasi-asosiasi. Agar mereka tahu customer need itu apa. Kemudian segmented pasar. Ya. Fokus ke customer. Cari customer siapa yang paling berbelanja besar, siapa yang menengah, dan lain-lain. Pilah-pilah mana yang fokus ke improvement, mana yang hanya pengguna produk biasa. Ya. Mana yang harus engagement-nya lebih besar, mana yang cukup dengan sekali pembelian saja. Ya. Segmented customer kita. Pilah-pilah. Ya. Tolong dianalisa. Ini yang harus kita lakukan. Kemudian fokus ke customer centric. Ya. Sekali lagi kurang lebih hampir sama. Cari tahu keinginan mereka itu apa sih? Harapan mereka itu apa sih? Dan yang paling enggak disukai mereka itu apa? Lakukan. Ya, dekati customer kita. Ya, customer itu adalah raja. Ya, nyari customer susah. Tapi setelah dapat customer, enggak dipelihara. Enggak di-maintain. Semua perusahaan yang bagus, mereka akan memaintain existing customer-nya melebihi mencari customer baru. Saya ulang. Sebuah perusahaan yang bagus akan memaintain existing customer-nya melebihi effort mencari customer yang baru. Ya, karena engagement yang bagus dengan customer yang loyal, malah mereka bisa menjual produk kita. Akad ya, mereka mempromosikan produk kita. Jadi, maintain existing customer kita. Kemudian, fokus ke hubungan, networking dan lain-lain. Teman-teman harus jago networking. Seorang sales itu harus jago networking. Ikut tadi asosiasi-asosiasi. Yang relevan ya. Jangan asosiasinya jualan produk otomotif, ikut asosiasi balet. Ya boleh sih, tapi ya kurang relevan. Gitu ya. Jadi cari asosiasi. Ikutan asosiasi. Aktif di asosiasi. Dengar suara customer. Ya. Karena ini inputan yang signifikan. Kemudian, adopsi apapun yang diinginkan oleh customer. Lakukan perubahan untuk jenis produk maupun layanan kita. Inovasi produk kita. Ya, perbaiki layanan kita dari waktu ke waktu. Ya, ini yang harus teman-teman lakukan. Kemudian, nah ini jangan lupa analisa kompetitor. Ya. Jadi cek mereka. Mereka udah sampai mana sih? Mereka fokusnya di mana sih? Mereka melakukan kesalahan apa sih? Dicek and recheck. Ya, jangan takut ya. Kadang-kadang diskusi dengan mereka. Karena mereka juga butuh feedback dari kita. Ya, rangkul customer. Rangkul kompetitor. Kemudian, nah ini tadi yang diajarin ya. Sudah 4.0 ya. Otomatisasi. Ya. Jangan tolak teknologi. CRM apapun itu produk atau jenis lainnya, robotik dan apapun harus dilakukan, ya. Jadi jangan tolak perubahan. Lakukan streamline. Kalau bisa dikerjakan satu orang, kenapa harus 10 orang datang? Lakukan effectiveness dan efisiensi. Jangan lupa latih tim kita, staff kita. Kadang-kadang kita fokus eksternal, tim kita loyo. Spiritnya, semangatnya enggak 4-5, cuma 2-5 dan lain-lain, ya. Upgrade. Semua orang sekarang harus bisa digital selling. Ya, dia jago Pak, melobi. Lobi itu zaman dulu, sepakat ya Pak ya? Traditional apa marketing masih oke lah lobby-lobby. Sekarang enggak, orang enggak face to face kok. Ya. Suruh mereka pelatihan digital marketing. Ya, jualan secara digital. Pak, saya gaptek. Oh, berarti ada yang salah. Ya. Upgrade tim kita. Dan nah ini tadi bicara fleksibel. Ya, fleksibel itu yang utama. Agile. Ya, kita harus cerdas dan lain-lain, ya. Selalu terbuka. Jangan menolak perubahan. Sekali lagi, jangan menolak perubahan. Oke, okay, ya. Sorry, lewat sedikit. Ada pertanyaan dari teman-teman? Mangga, silakan.
Alright, we open the Q&A forum. Now we have one question. Anyone who ask, who would like to ask one question?
Silakan, kalau ada yang ingin bertanya. Materinya bisa di-download ya. Ini, silakan. Teman-teman
yang mau dulu. Alright, meantime, we're ready. Okay. Later after this question, we will have our lucky draw at the end of this presentation today. Any questions in Bahasa?
I think everybody needs to the lucky draw.
That's a big question.
Alright, come on. Silakan, Pak.
Pak, what is the main, Pak, after the pandemic, pick up with your presentation, what is the basic feature of the Indonesian customers or marketing behavior of the customer, the consumers after the main, Pak, of course you mentioned about the SDG, lingkungan, environment, IT, or and technology, Pak. Is there anything else by which is changing after the behavior of the Indonesian customer?
Okay, thank you, Pak. Pertanyaan luar biasa. Asumsinya gini, ya, pelihara perubahan. Kemarin itu kita dipaksa, Pak, berubah dengan pandemi. Ya, suka nggak suka. Katanya seleksi alam. Perusahaan-perusahaan hebat banyak yang berguguran. Ya, perusahaan biasa dan jualannya lebih bagus. Ya, jadi ini seleksi alam. Dan akan ada pandemi-pandemi lainnya. Ya teman-teman, walaupun mungkin nggak drastis COVID ya, akan ada pandemi-pandemi lainnya yang akan datang. Nah, apakah kita bisa tetap beradaptasi dan berubah? Ya, yang penting itu adalah perubahan. Kalau mau saya pakai quote, never stop improving. Ya, selalu lakukan perubahan. Ya, apapun itu perubahan kecil, ya, yang bisa konsisten dan istiqomah dijalankan, lakukan terus. Jangan perubahan tuh baru dinilai kalau signifikan. Enggak. Small things saja, tapi konsisten is the good thing. Ya, jadi lakukan perubahan yang kecil-kecil, tapi konsisten dibanding yang signifikan setelah itu stop. Ya, ini rumus sebuah perubahan. Jadi kalau Bapak jawab, ya pelihara selalu perubahan. Kalau dulu banyak departemen yang ada namanya departemen apa ya? Business development dan lain-lain. Ya. Sekarang dirubah ke judulnya, ya. Lebih banyak orang lebih ke simple thing, lebih ke sustainability. Bicaranya mereka masuk ke definisi sustainability. Karena parameternya harus berubah terus, ya. Annual report, sustainability report itu parameternya harus berubah, harus lebih baik dari waktu ke waktu. Simpelnya kurang lebih seperti itu. Jadi lakukan perubahan kecil tapi konsisten, itulah yang harus dilakukan oleh teman-teman. Kecil tapi konsisten. Mudah-mudahan menjawab ya, Pak.
Oke, okay, big hands. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So, at this end of this.
Oke, okay, thank you. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you. So now we move to our final activity before we close this conference, the lucky draw. But before we pick out our lucky winners of the special gifts, we would like to ask you to answer this survey. The QR code is on the wall, please scan it. And yeah, the QR code will uncover of the conference folder, or you can scan this one on the screen. So Ben, are we ready?
Let's give it to
Okay, 2 minutes.
Catherine?
Yes.
Thank you.
Terima kasih. And Catherine, we are all ready.
Okay. Okay, 30 seconds.
All right.
So, ready with the camera and ready with the gift and also the drone. Okay. Let's welcome Mr. Zhao to pick out our lucky winner. We only have 2 gifts. Yes, exactly. Yes, we can start now. Exactly. Yes, let's start now. Rajan H.
Yeah. Dajar H from PT Trivitra Chitra Master.
Oh, he's outside. Wonderful. Congrats, Rajan. Yeah, Draja, that's you? Oh, Draja! Similar name. Okay, welcome. Oh, wonderful. Congratulations. Yeah. Okay, picture. Congrats. Okay, one more.
Thank you.
Okay, one more. Okay, mix it up. Okay. Last one.
Okay, Sophia from PTTUV North Indonesia.
Sophia.
Sophia here. It's for the CE certificate organizer, right?
Oh, really? Welcome.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Right here. Yeah. Congratulations. Picture. Okay. Thank you. That's the end of our lucky draw activity. I hope you all have a great time for these 2 days. Who had a great time for these 2 days? Please give me a big hand. Thank you very much. Now this comes to an end to this conference. Thank you very much for all the participants of those conference, the delegates, our speakers, and business partners outside. All the industry associations who joined and supported Ringer events in making this conference a success. We are very grateful and we hope that we will see you again next conference. Thank you. Don't forget, lunch is
not downstairs.
Yes, of course. Lunch is served at the next room. Okay, that's why I have to make it announced. Thank you and have a great day ahead. Thank you. Okay. While you are leaving this room, I would like to remind those who are about to join the factory tour, please go to our counter, go to our staff. Make sure that on time, we'll be waiting at you at first floor at the gate at 1:15, and we will set out. We will start our journey at 1:30. All right. Don't forget to bring your name tag, your lunch coupon, okay, with you to go to our lunch room.
Yeah, taking pictures. I'll leave this thing for all of you. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's better.